Ramadan.
Welcome, O Ramadan.
The month of mercy and blessings. Fasting does not mean to stay hungry and thirsty and make it troublesome for you. Fasting is an act of self-restraint. Do not speak evil. Do not see evil. Do not think evil. Do not do anything indecent. Fasting is a trial for the believers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let's triumph in this trial according to the guidelines of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the sunnah of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. I'll be there for you all through this glorious month of Ramadan. Let's make it more fruitful and reward worthy. Share it with me every day throughout this blessed month.
Let's benefit from Ramadan. Meet Dr. Zakir Naik in Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakir, next on Peace TV.
Muhammad, peace
pearls of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Abu Huraira, may Allah be pleased with him, narrated that Allah's Messenger, peace be upon him, said, Allah looks not at your figures nor at your possessions, but he looks at your hearts and deeds. Sahih Muslim, Volume 4, Kitabul Bir, Wasila wal Adab, Book of Virtues, Good Manners and Joining of the Ties of Relationships, Chapter 1060, Hadith Number 6221.
1:1, 1:5, 1:10, 1:50, 1:100, 1:700.
This Ramadan too, the census of returns for a good deed will shoot up by 70,000%. Be prepared.
Welcome, O Ramadan.
Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakir.
Dear brothers and sisters in Islam and humanity, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May the peace, the mercy and the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. Welcome to the show Ramadan, A Date with Dr. Zakir. I'm your host Yusuf Chambers, and today we will be discussing the topic,
part 2 of
Common Errors Committed by Muslims During the Month of Ramadan.
Dr. Zakir, Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
It's a very common question, and it's one that I'd like to know the answer to as well. It's, if all the devils are chained during the month of Ramadan, how come people continue to commit sins?
Alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salam ala rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. And I do agree with you, this is a common question, and I remember several years back when I was in school and when I heard this hadith that the devils are chained in the month of Ramadan, immediately the question that came to my mind and the question that comes to many Muslims' mind and many non-Muslims is, that if the devils are chained, then how do people, how do human beings yet commit sins? This question is based on the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which I mentioned earlier, a sahih hadith of Musnad Ahmad, volume number 2, page number 230, hadith number 7148, which is also repeated in Sunan Nisa'i, chapter number 5, hadith number 2106, where the beloved Prophet said that, O people, the blessed month of Ramadan is approaching, and Allah has ordained for you that you fast in this month, and the gates of heaven will be open in this month, and the gates of hell will be closed, and the devils will be chained. In this month is a night which is better than 1,000 months, and a person who is deprived of the blessing in this month is truly a deprived person. So when we give this hadith, it clearly mentions that in this month of Ramadan, the devils will be chained. And it's a logical question. If devils are chained, then how do human beings yet commit sins? To make the people understand, we have to realize that when the devils are chained, it does not mean that the devils are slain. They have been killed. They are yet present, but they are chained. They are not killed. The power is yet there, but it is diminished. For a better understanding, I like to give you an example that when there is a lion or a tiger who is free, there are high chances that he may kill you. Your life is in danger. But the moment that tiger or that lion is chained, you are safe. You are safe as long as you maintain a safe distance. After the tiger has been chained, if you come too close to him, there are chances yet you can be killed. So as long as you maintain that distance from the tiger who is chained, you are safe. Similarly, in the month of Ramadan, if you maintain a safe distance from the Satan, you will be saved. And if you read the Quran, Allah says in Surah Baqarah, chapter 2, verse number 168, be careful of the khutwatu shaitan, of the footsteps of the devil, for he is to you an avowed enemy. Many places Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran that be careful of the footsteps of the devil. Allah doesn't say that be careful of the devil, because a normal Muslim, an average Muslim who has average iman, when he sees the devil in front of him, he will be careful. For example, suppose there's a young girl who comes to an average Muslim, a young boy who has average iman. If a young girl comes and tells him that let's spend the night together, that Muslim will say, spending the night together with a girl, it's haram, it is zina. He will immediately object. But that same girl, if that girl phones that young boy and speaks to him on the phone, the boy will say, speaking to a girl on the phone, there is no problem. So he speaks to the girl for a few times on the phone for a few minutes. Later on, the girl says, let's go and have some snacks in McDonald's on Kentucky Fried Chicken. Having snacks for a few minutes, for half an hour with a girl in McDonald's, no problem. So he goes and has snacks with the girl in McDonald's. Later on, the girl says, why not have dinner in a restaurant? Having dinner with a girl in a restaurant for a couple of hours, no problem. Then the girl says, why not spend the night together? And then the boy says, spending the night together with a girl, no problem. So this is khutwatu shaitan, footsteps of the devil. This is not mentioned in the Quran, this is just my own example. So what Allah warns us is that be careful of the khutwatu shaitan, the footsteps of the devil. If the devil comes directly in front of an average Muslim who has iman, he will abstain, he will run away from it. But the khutwatu shaitan are the things which are dangerous. So what we have to realize, when the devil is chained, his footsteps are restricted. So many of the sins are prevented. But if we go close to him, then the chances that we'll be overtaken by the devil and commit a sin are very high. So what we have to be careful, that in Ramadan, if we keep the distance, then the chance of committing sin is less. But if we go close to the Satan, even though he's chained, like how a tiger can walk even after he's chained, same the devil. So this is my understanding. And the beloved Prophet said, the devils are chained, the devil can yet move. But less distance. So if we keep the distance, we'll be safe. The second reason that I feel is that in the month of Ramadan, though the devils are chained, we fail to realize that the balance 11 months, they are free. And the impact that the devil has on the human beings for these 11 months, it leaves those impact, that impression in the month of Ramadan. To give a better understanding, I always give the example that there are drug peddlers which try and get customers, the youngsters from the colleges, from the universities. So what they do initially, they give the drug free and they entice the youngsters for having drugs. Later on, after some time, they charge a nominal amount for that drug. Later on, they charge an exorbitant amount. But by the time, the youngster is already hooked on to the drug. So even if the drug dealer is not there, they will try and find where the drug dealer is. They will go out of the way to find him and get the drug. And many of them, even if the drug peddler, the drug dealer, is imprisoned by the law, they will go out of the way to find someone else. They may go in a chemist shop and buy mandrakes, whatever it is. They are so much hooked on to it. So these people who have become addicts to drugs, or rather say, addicted to the Satan, even though the Satan is imprisoned, the effect is yet there. So this we understand as a drug dealer, as a drug peddler, even after he goes, the drug addict gets accustomed to that drug. So we human beings, we are accustomed to the sin. And even though the Satan is imprisoned, we keep on committing these mistakes. But mainly those people who have become addicts fall in this category. So those who do major sin fall in this category. But the normal Muslims, the average Muslims who haven't become addicted, it's easy for them to stay away from sin. And the third reason that I give is that though there are some scholars who say that in this month of Ramadan, the strong devils, the marids, they're imprisoned. The smaller ones are free. So they keep on committing mistakes. But according to my understanding, the third reason is that though the devils are chained by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they can yet whisper. And one of the ways the devils try and get the human beings close to them is by whispering. And Allah says in the Quran, in Surah Nas, chapter number 114, verse number 1-6, قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ مَلِكِ النَّاسِ إِلَهِ النَّاسِ مِنْ شَرِّ الْوَسْوَاسِ الْخَنَّاسِ الَّذِي يُوَسْوِسُ فِي صُدُورِ النَّاسِ مِنَ الْجِنَّةِ وَالنَّاسِ. They whisper in the hearts of the human beings and they withdraw. Amongst them, the jinn and men. It's talking about the Satans, talking about the devils, who whisper into the hearts of the human being and they withdraw. And among these devils are the jinn and the human beings. So maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has imprisoned the devils who are the jinn. But the human beings, we, are yet free. So one category of devils that the jinns have been imprisoned, but the Satans are even amongst the men. That's what Allah says. Who are yet free. And yet we have to be careful of the whisper of the devil. The waswasa. This waswasa mainly is the thing that attracts towards the sin. The sins they had committed, but the chances are less. And furthermore, it's clearly mentioned in the full hadith that Allah has ordained for you in this month of Ramadan that you should fast. Only if you fast, according to me, will the devils be imprisoned. That's talking about the devils that are going to attract you. So Allah says, if you fast, Allah has ordained for you fasting, and the devils will be put in chains. So the devils that are after you, if you fast, surely they'll be restricted. The criteria for us to be away from the devil is to fast. If you fast with the proper niyyah, seeking the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, surely the devil will not be able to entice you. And the best logical way to prove this is if we check the crime rate of the Muslim countries during Ramadan, it goes down. But if you check the crime rate of the non-Muslim countries in Ramadan, it is the same. The reason is that because they are not fasting, the non-Muslims, this devil yet has an effect on them. Because the Muslims are fasting, if not all properly, at least majority, or at least quite a large number, so because of that, the crime rate in the Muslim countries in the month of Ramadan is low as compared to the other months. But the crime rate in the non-Muslim country is approximately the same, indicating otherwise even the non-Muslims, they will not commit any sins. So the criteria is that you have to fast properly for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And now, brothers and sisters, we'll have a short break. Inshallah, see you after the break.
It is
Ramadan beckons us to give our zakat, an important farz and a pillar of Islam. Several fatwas of distinguished scholars of Islam worldwide state that zakat can be given to support a non-profit Islamic satellite channel whose aim is to spread the truth of Islam. Every dollar you contribute helps Peace TV to refute allegations against Islam, misconceptions about Quran. What better choice do you have to spread the truth of Islam than Peace TV?
Support Peace TV. Send your zakat and donation to Islamic Research Foundation International, Islamic Bank of Britain, Coventry Road, Birmingham, UK. Account number 011-32301, sort code 300083.
Peace TV,
the solution for humanity. A friendly message by Dr. Zakir, the last testament of God.
It is a proclamation to humanity, a fountain of mercy and wisdom, a guide to the erring, a warning to the heedless, an assurance to those in doubt, a solace to the suffering, a hope to those in despair. Al-Quran, the most positive book in the world, the final message of God to humanity. Let's read it, understand it, and follow it.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.
It is Ramadan.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And welcome back to the show, Ramadan, a date with Dr. Zakir. I'm your host, Yusuf Chambers, and today we are discussing a topic, common errors committed by Muslims during the month of Ramadan. So Dr. Zakir, are there, to your mind, any important sunnahs of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that people avoid because they feel it will nullify their fast?
Yes, there are a few sunnahs of the Prophet which many Muslims avoid thinking it will break their fast or it is makruh. And the most important sunnah of the Prophet which people avoid during Ramadan is using the sawakh, using the toothstick. Many Muslims feel that if they use this, it is makruh. The main reason is there's a hadith of Muhammad, a hadith which is mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 3, Book of Fasting, hadith number 1904, where the beloved Prophet said, I swear by Allah, in whose hand is the soul of Muhammad, peace be upon him, that the breath of the person who fasts is more sweeter to Allah than the scent of musk. Now, based on this hadith, many Muslims think that if they use the siwak, the breath, the bad breath or the foul breath of the person who fasts will not be there and it will not please Allah. That's the reason they avoid using siwak. Now, these people, they fail to realize that when we use the stick, siwak, it does not remove the breath, the foul breath or the breath which people normally don't like of the person who fasts. The siwak mainly brushes the gums, it cleans the teeth, it helps in keeping the teeth healthy, but in no way does it reduce the breath, especially of the person who fasts. And furthermore, there's the sunnah of the Prophet, where Prophet Muhammad, he said, it's mentioned in Sahih Bukhari, volume number 2, hadith number 88, our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, that if it wouldn't have been too hard for my ummah, I would have made it compulsory for them to use the siwak, the toothstick, before every prayer. Or to use the toothstick while doing wudu. Like how wudu is a requirement before salah. The Prophet, if it wouldn't have been too difficult for the ummah, he would have made it compulsory to use the toothstick. And here, he did not mention any exceptions. Other would have said, I would have made it compulsory for my ummah except during fasting. This important sunnah, surely if this would have been makruh while fasting, would have nullified the fast, surely he would have mentioned it. So this proved that this is an important sunnah which Muslims should continue doing, even during the month of Ramadan, even while fasting, it will not nullify their fast. It's not makruh, in fact, it is mustahab, it's encouraged. And the other important sunnah which people neglect or avoid, mainly fearing that it will spoil their fast or nullify their fast, is putting water in the nostrils, sniffing the water, normally, especially during wudu. So many of the Muslims, even when they do wudu, they just get the water close to the nose and touch the tip of the nose to the water, that's it. They don't put the water into the nostrils and they clean their nose, they don't sniff it, which is a requirement for wudu, thinking that if they sniff, it may break the fast. Water entering through the nose into your throat will nullify the fast. But the chances are very negligible. What our beloved Prophet Muhammad said, it's mentioned in Sahih Hadith of Abu Dawud, volume number 2, Hadith number 2360. Our beloved Prophet said that when you do wudu, sniff the water excessively, except in fasting. So normally when we do wudu, we sniff the water excessively, except in fasting. Because in fasting, if we sniff excessively, there are chances, though very negligible, for it to enter the throat and nullifying your fast. But normally when we put water in the nostrils, there are no chances of it going in the throat. So only care that we have to take while fasting is, don't sniff excessively, but we have to put the water in the nostrils and clean the nostrils, which is important sunnah, which many of the Muslims neglect, and they avoid it, especially during wudu. And here, since the Prophet clearly mentioned, except fasting, during the siwak, he said, I would have made it compulsory had it not been difficult for my ummah. There, because he doesn't say fasting, it means that siwak can be used while fasting, and sniffing should not be done excessively, but normally water should be put in the nostrils while doing wudu. So these two important sunnahs, which people out of ignorance, they avoid during fasting.
Now, Dr. Zakir, well, the last question today regarding Prophet Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam's statement, which you mentioned in your last answer, regarding the fact the gates of paradise are open and the gates of hell are closed. Does this mean that we will be going to paradise if we die in this blessed month?
This again is the same question, related to the same hadith which I quoted earlier of Musnad Ahmad, verse number 2, page number 230, hadith number 7148, and it also appears in Sunan Nisai, chapter number 5. Hadith number 2106. Again the same hadith, the Prophet said, he told the people that the blessed month of Ramadan is approaching and Allah has ordained for you that you fast in this month. And in this month, the gates of heaven will be open and the gates of hell will be closed and the devils will be chained. In this month is the night of Qadr, which is more blessed than 1,000 months. And a person who is deprived of the pleasures of the blessings in this month is truly a deprived person. Here again, this is a common question, that if the gates of heaven are open and the gates of hell are closed, then anyone who dies but naturally go to Jannah, because the gates of hell are closed and Jannah open. Does it mean that even if a non-Muslim dies in this month, even he'll have to go to Jannah? The reply to this question is, when Allah says that in this month of Ramadan the gates of heaven are open, it means the gates of heaven are inviting you to enter Jannah. That means that even if you do a small deed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will multiply your reward. Another Prophet said that every deed will get a reward 10 times. And in this month, it's very easy to enter Jannah. When our Prophet said, the gates of hell will be closed, indicating that to enter hell is difficult in this month. Why? Because the taqwa level rises and the chances of you to commit sin is less. And furthermore, if you fast the full month in the month of Ramadan, seeking Allah's reward, all your past sins will be forgiven. So the moment the person fasts in this complete month of Ramadan, seeking Allah's reward, all his past sins are completely forgiven. So if the past sins are forgiven, the chances of him going to hell is nil. But what we have to realize, the criteria for the gates of heaven to be open and the gates of hell to be closed is that you have to fast. And furthermore, to enter Jannah, you require a ticket. The ticket to go to Jannah is mentioned in the Quran in Surah Al-Asr, chapter number 103, verse number 1 to 3, where Allah says, Wal Asr, innal insana lafi khusr, illa allazina amanu wa amilu salihati, fatawasaw bil haqqi wa tawasaw bis sabr. That by the token of time, man is verily in a state of loss, except those who have faith, those who do righteous deeds, those who exhort people to truth, and those who exhort people to patience and perseverance. This surah, according to Imam Shafi, he said that only if this surah was to be revealed of the Quran, it would have been sufficient for the salvation of mankind. So important is. It is called as Rahe Nijat, the way for salvation. And the criteria for any human being to enter Jannah is four. First is Iman. Second is righteous deeds. Third is exhorting people to truth. And fourth is exhorting people to patience and perseverance. So here we realize that the gates of heaven are open, but just because the gates are open, you can't enter, you require the ticket. The ticket is Iman. The ticket is righteous deed. Exhorting people to truth, exhorting people to patience and perseverance. And to get this ticket is very easy in the month of Ramadan, because the Iman level rises in the month of Ramadan. Furthermore, your righteous deed, the reward is multiplied. It's easier. You can call people to truth, your patient level increases. So this hadith means that you have to have the criteria. Then inshallah you shall go to Jannah and you will not go to hell. But that doesn't mean that 100% people who die will go to Jannah. Surely those are non-believers, they have got no Iman. So there's no question that they will enter Jannah. If a person has to enter Jannah, he requires a ticket. And the ticket to Jannah is Surah Al-Asr. Furthermore, if you read the hadith, it says that only if you fast in the month of Ramadan, that means, and you follow all the rules and regulations, and abstain from things which are prohibited, then the doors of heaven will be open and the gates of hell will be closed. Furthermore, it says, in this month is a night which is equivalent to more than 1,000 months, indicating that even if you pray and worship to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this one night, it will be equivalent to more than 1,000 months, is about more than 80 years. Imagine. So the chances for you to get a reward only in this one night is more than a lifetime. An average human being lives for 60 years. So one Laylatul Qadr is more than 1,000 months, is about more than 80 years. More than average life of a human being. The chances are very easy to go to Jannah. And the ending part of the hadith says, a person who is deprived of these blessings is truly a deprived person, indicating that everyone will not go to Jannah. Everyone will not find the doors of heaven open. It says, the ending part, very important, that a person who is deprived of the blessings in this month is truly a deprived person. That means telling us Muslims that if you cannot get the benefits of the month of Ramadan, and then if you cannot go to Jannah, then you are truly a deprived person. That even includes the non-Muslims who haven't got the hidayah. They are truly the deprived people.
So Dr. Zakir, well, Jazakallah khair, and I thank you for those intriguing answers, particularly pertaining to the last two questions which you answered so eloquently. MashaAllah, Alhamdulillah. Brothers and sisters, I hope you benefited as much as I did today by listening to the show. And tomorrow we shall be discussing an introduction to Ramadan, inshaAllah. Assalamu alaikum, until tomorrow at the same time.
بيتنا خاشعين مسلمين مؤمنين للإله عابدين
شهرنا صبر وعتق وقنوت فيه صدق يومنا صبر ورق بدموع البائسين
رمضان قد أهل بالصيام وأطل مسعدا أهلا وخلا لجهو في كل
A friendly message by Dr. Zakir. The most profitable business.
Would you like to know the business in which you earn the maximum profit? The secret is given in the glorious Quran. In Surah Al-Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 261. The example of those who spend their wealth in the way of Allah is like a seed of grain, which grows 7 spikes. In each spike is 100 grains. And Allah multiplies His reward to whom He wills. If you spend your wealth in the way of Allah, you'll get a return of 700 times. In business terminology, you'll get a profit of 70,000%. Is there any business you know of in which you'll get a better return? Invest today in the way of Allah.
Peace TV, the solution for humanity.